You have a Bible, please turn to Deuteronomy chapter 5. And we are reading actually verse 6 to 10. Just a very quick background. Brother Roy Lam has already started to ask about these 10 commandments. And we are going to go through the 10 commandments. There is only a little bit of exchange today since it's physical. Worship, I thought I would do physical because Pastor Andy is in Egypt. All right, so as we continue today, I will touch on the first two commandments. The first two commandments, okay? And I have entitled it Worship Him Alone. Actually, that title also came from Roy. I just worship Him Alone. And I find it's very, very appropriate. But let me say this today. The Ten Commandments is as old as it can be. We have heard about it and everything, everybody, right? You may not be able to give what is the Ten Commandments in terms of that, but it is as old as it can be, but it is also as difficult as it can be to follow. That does not give us the excuse that we can drop them. We are expected observe and obey every single one of them, every single one at all costs. I want to start by putting this very, very clearly. They are 10 commandments direct from God, written with His own hand, engraved in stone so that we can always go back even if we forget. They are not 10 suggestions. Right? It's commandments. It's not 10 suggestions. So as I read from verse 6 onwards, where it starts with the first commandment, I am the Lord your God. Commandment who brought you out of Egypt and out of the land of slavery. You find this in Exodus 20 also, it's repeated. You shall have no other gods before me. Commandment number 2. You shall not, then it goes down and it speaks a little bit more. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children of the sin of their fathers to a third and a fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to a thousand generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. So, my dear people, what does the first commandment say? It says, He is the one that created us. He is the creator God. We do not exist except that He has created us. I want to see you to see how holy and how high this God is. He created us and He also rescued us. I want you to see how personal this God is, as big as He is, as powerful as He is. He rescued us from slavery. That's commandment number one. I am the Lord, your God, He declares. It's not something you decide whether He's God or not. I'm sad that the world thinks they can decide who is God. Here, clearly from the start, He said, I am your God. What is the second commandment? If you read carefully, He says, you shall have no other gods before me. In the Hebrew term, it's not that you put another God there. In fact, it doesn't say, you shall have no other God except me. It sounds that way only. But in essence, if you study it a little bit deeper and you put the two commandments together, He says, you will never try to represent me in any form. Not even a cross. Not even a Bible to think that it's powerful and this is God. Are you getting me? Don't try to represent God in any form, because he is far too great about it. On Friday, I just did a little test. I say, you like me to represent you or not? He said, no, thank you. I didn't quote exactly that, but he surely didn't want me to represent him, because I would have misrepresented him. I don't look as handsome as him. I don't look as strong as him. What about God? How can we represent him? So when he says, you shall have no idols, it just simply says, don't represent me in another way or in any form. Don't try to do that. Now, I want to say something before I join these two commandments together. They are joined together to me. You know, we very often are deceived in thinking, yes, I believe in God Almighty. He's my one and only true living God. And I also know in the life that I live now, I don't have any idols, physical or just my parents or my children or anything like that. Then I am doing fine. I love God. I don't have any idols. And we are contented just to say we are okay. But I tell you, we are not okay. We are not okay. Because these two commandments, when you put them down together, and then you see the following verse that talks more about it, which I will not go into, it's basically about, it basically comes down to this. You distill these two. I am your God. You shall have no idols. What God is giving to us today is this. You shall worship me alone. And that worship is through a relationship. A real and continuous relationship. A personal relationship with me. That's how he wants us to worship him. Through a real and personal relationship with him. But how do we know this is happening? Too often we think it is the mode, the method. And in John 4:23, it clearly tells us it's not about mode. While it is important, but it is not about mode of worship, but it is the spirit of worship. It is what's in your heart when you worship God. John 4:23 says, the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. That means there are some worshipers the Lord doesn't want. Those who go through idols. Those who try to imagine him, put the cross on the door there, that I can remember Jesus died on the cross. He wants a real and personal relationship. He said, therefore, verse 24, God is spirit and his worshiper must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now, several years back, I used the word acronym worship. And this is how I have represented it. I say in every worship, now this is more on the mode or the elements of worship. All right, which I'm not talking about today. These are the elements. In every worship, the word must be preached. In every worship, there must be orderliness. And I'm going to change some of this today as the Lord put upon my heart. Orderliness, I mean, we don't come in any way we want. We just sing any song, we choose any song we like, we do it whatever way. We can change the order here and there. And I use the word ACTS. We come before God and adore him because he's worthy of adoration. We confess our unworthiness before him. And we thank him that we have forgiveness in Christ. And then we pray for others and for ourselves, that they will catch the element of it. That's what I mean by orderliness. It's not the liturgy that I'm talking about. I thought that some years back, most of us would have forgotten it. And I said there must be reverence. I believe in coming into the place of God, and when we are about to worship, when we are starting to worship, that we should kind of wait and say that, hey, here is the VIP, or should I say VVIP now. It is his time. And not just forget about. I believe in dressing, I believe in punctuality. You know, in the Bible, there's this man who was invited to a banquet. And when he came, he was chased out. He was invited, but he was chased out. Now, go and look at that chapter there, and if you reflect upon it, it's very interesting, because every person who was invited, it was the host at that time to provide them a robe that is appropriate for the wedding banquet. They didn't want him to look shabby or dirty or anything, because he was taken from the byways and highways. But he came, everybody was provided an appropriate thing. I suggest we dress appropriately for worship. That's what I thought. We dress appropriately. And I know people don't like that example. You don't go and see our prime minister in shorts and broken t-shirts. You try your best, unless you're caught unaware. Anyway, that is one thing I say. And I talk about being spirit-led. That the Holy Spirit feels welcome because of our few earlier, you know, attitude towards it. And then I said there must be instruction. At every worship, there must be instruction where you take and you go out and you practice it. If you don't practice it, what's the point? It's just knowledge. And when we do all this, it ends up with praise to God. Today, I'm going to use the same acronym, and I'm going to use these two commandments together and to see if we are keeping these two commandments. That says, I am the Lord your God. Do we have the attitude that when I come, God has declared that he is my God? Do I come in and say, Lord, no idols? Not the physical idols, but Lord, I come, and I will explain it, but I come, Lord, with no idols except that you are my God. Number one, the word must be for the final authority. You know you are approaching God in worship the right way if you come and say, whatever the word says, as long as it's in the word, I have to obey. It's a command. It's not a suggestion. It's not to be debated. It is not important what I preach. It's important that you check and to see that it is in the Word of God. I might have said things that might not be accurate. You need to read the Word. And that's why going back to basic starts with Bible reading. The Word must be the final authority. You cannot view the Word as you check whether you are at home, you're doing your devotion or whatever, as suggestion, as being obsolete. This is the long ago, your generation, daddy, your generation, grandfather, but not our generation. Obsolete and irrelevant, you think it is. Today, we cannot think like that anymore. I spoke about baby dedication, and I said, don't take the perspective of the world. You cannot delegate the bringing of the child to somebody else. It's your duty. It's clear in the Word of God. So when you come, you must be prepared to accept the Word as the final authority. Maybe you have never heard of it before. Maybe you have never learned of it before. And you hear the preacher say it for the first time. And you say, I do not know. I do not believe that this should be the way or whatever is the way. Don't stop there. Go home. Be like the Bereans. Read up the Bible. And if you see it in the Bible, obey it. It's not the preacher. Some preacher can make you laugh. Some preacher can tell you long stories. Some preacher can scold you like me, like that, or almost like scolding like that. It is not important. It's whether the word is the final authority. So, true worship starts when in spirit, when you dropped all your perspective. You know, we come into church, we all have our perspective. We come to church, we all have our theology. We come in this way. And we need to drop them at the door and say, Lord, I come empty of any agenda but to hear you speak from your word. Second, there must be that obedience. There must be that obedience, a willingness to receive and obey. If you come here, you are not willing, and God already tell you, this is adultery, this is stealing. You already know, but you're not willing. Even if the preacher preach exactly on that, and God uses the preacher, it doesn't help. He is not the God who saved you. You are having an idol that you are clinging on to. There must be obedience in every area of your life. You don't say, God, you know, I'm serving you, Lord. And all that. You come to the sanctuary. There is a mighty God who said, I am the God who saves you from slavery. You bow down and you say, Lord, I have sinned against you. I confess and I'm willing to obey and give it up. Do you have the attitude when you come to worship? When we say worship God alone, this is what it means. Willingness to obey without withholding anything at all cost. No cost. Cannot say this is too costly. Not possible. How can I just do this? How can I do that? If it's in the word, there must be that willingness to obey. Then next, reverence. If you look up the word reverence, synonyms, and other things that close to it, or how it is used in the Bible, usually it is exemplified by such word, being humble. God speaks a word, I'm humble. I don't stand out there in arrogance. Being submissive, I submit to him. Being respectful. Being honoring. I honor him. You say, you know, you go to a king, you go to a king's presence, you go to a queen's presence, and the king is down there, and you come in, you have some ideas and everything and all that. If the king says, shh, you give reverence. You keep quiet. You don't just chatter on like nothing at all. That's reverence, giving the proper respect and the proper attitude towards it. Now you say, how does this apply? Let me suggest to you, when we revere God, we come on his terms, not our terms. We come on his terms, God's terms, not our terms, not our preference, not our demand. I learned this, that sometimes I come into the worship, Lord, I want an answer to this, Lord. Why is this happening to me? Why do I have cancer? I want an answer, Lord. I must learn to drop that. If he so choose, how big? I tell you what, you go and forgive this brother and sister. Or how big, I tell you, you go and feed this poor first. Reverence means you have the last say. You say it, it is your agenda, and you do it. Not on our own preference. Not coming to worship with something with our agenda. Now let me say this a little bit. More often, we come in, we want a blessing. Lord, every Sunday I come, you bless my career. Lord, I come because I want to have a marriage partner. I come because I want my health to be. When God wants to deal with another issue and doesn't want to deal with this issue, we give reverence when we allow Him to do that. When we allow Him to do that. Let me bring it closer to us. We can actually physically worship every Sunday. We had better be very clear why we have a preference for something else. If our preference is because it's convenience, or just because we prefer, and it's less risky, I suggest we relook at it. I'm not saying it's wrong, but I suggest we relook at it. Why do you prefer Zoom over physical, individually? Don't talk about leadership's decision. I prefer Zoom because I can be in my pajamas and sit down. I can go and get a cup of coffee during worship, whatever worship song is being played. I suggest there's an element of reverence that we should look into. I suggest to you, I know I'm going to make a lot of people angry because I've said it many times and I'm going to say it over here. It is very not reverential, and it's very disrespectful when you don't turn on your video at home small group or at worship Zoom session. You are disrespectful to the speaker. I know you have your reasons, and I can accept that. But more and more are not turning our videos on. What is God to us? I have shared the advantage of physical worship. Why is it an audit? So if it's a preference, it's a convenience, it's because you demand it to be this way and everything, we got to look into this element of, do I give reverence to God? If you put your preference above coming into His presence, then I suggest to you, you are idol worshipping yourself. You are more important than God. I am your God. You shall have no idols before me. Yes, sure, it's a hard attitude, but how well can you show your heart attitude? Not to people or to anything. That is something that I think we need to look into. You got to think about. You come on God's terms, not on our terms. You come punctually on God's terms. It's not because of the leaders or anything like that. It's the individual. Here he's talking about worship God alone. Don't forget that. Sometimes we worship God, I don't doubt that, but not alone. We have a little idol there, my convenience. I have a little idol there, I like my privacy. I have my little idol there, I don't have to be 100% transparent. Next is surrender. Full surrender is slightly different from obedience. Don't link it together. You can give obedience reluctantly without surrendering. God says so lah, okay? I do it lah. It is always this way. Not that obedience is no good. It may start with a reluctant obedience or an obedience that is just a little bit half, not fully. Then you go and God encounter you. Just like the rich ruler. I've obeyed everything and done everything from young. But the Lord says, but one thing you lack. Go sell everything, then come follow me. Did he follow? Did he sell everything? He couldn't surrender. That part there. But we have another example in the Bible which we are glad that this is not a good example, this is negative. We have one that is a positive example, Simon Peter the fisherman. When he caught no fish throughout the whole day and Jesus said, throw your net into the water, into deeper water and everything. His answer to Jesus, Lord, I have tried a whole day, I caught no fish, but if you say so, I do it lah. If you say so, I will do it. That was a reluctant obedience, but we are thankful that he obeyed. He felt compelled to do so. He felt he is forced to do so. And he did it because he saw Jesus as someone, a teacher, someone who is more than him. So he said, I do it lah. Just like sometimes we see God say so, I do it lah. And then when he caught so much fish, he realized something. Read that chapter yourself, okay? When he caught so much fish, in Luke chapter 5, he caught so much fish, he realized something is amiss. Because Jesus was telling him to catch fish at the wrong time. Caught no fish whole day, right? At night. No fish. Jesus told him to use the wrong method. They should be near the shore, not deeper. Jesus said, put into deeper water. And it was the wrong place because the fish are not there simply because it was natural during that year. That part of the place has very little fish, but they got no choice. They got to earn a living, catch. So they caught nothing. Wrong place, wrong time, wrong method. By one who knows nothing, according to Peter. So he reluctantly do it lah. Just saw, this is a great teacher I've been following. Okay, you tell me do it, I do it lah. Reluctantly he cast. And then there was so much fish, he encountered God. You know what I mean by encounter God? He suddenly realized, no one can do such a thing. It cannot be chance. You say it's a miracle. Let me tell you, it's more than a miracle. He is saying, this is God who can do this only. Can call the fish and get caught in the net. And that's why he bowed down. He knelt down. And he answered, go away from me. For I am a sinner. That's where he came from, reluctant obedience to an encounter, and then he surrendered. And then Jesus knew that. And Jesus said, from now on, you will not be fishermen, but you'll be fishers of men. When we give the right worship, our life will be transformed. When we encounter God, our life will be transformed. And then there is another example in Isaac, in Genesis 26. It's very interesting. Isaac was living in a country and then he was doing very well. Then the king Abimelech didn't like him because he said, you have become too powerful. Go away from us. So he moved away and he redug. He opened up the well that his father, Abraham, had. Because the Philistine didn't like it, they it up with soil so that they will not be able to. He redug it. Asked to leave when he was powerful. Go dig out. He dig up. The servants fight over it. Nothing said about Isaac. Nothing said about prayer. Nothing at all. No directions from God or instructions from God at all. He just left that place. He went to the next place. No claiming, this is my right. This is my agenda. He went, he redug, he opened up another well belonging to his father. Fight again. Fight again. And he says, okay. He went to the third one. Dig up. This time there is enough. And so he called the well sufficient. But you know what? He also left it there and he moved on to Beersheba. Now that is what I call surrender. No compulsion, no exercising of rights, no saying this is my father's, no heritage claim, nothing whatever. He surrendered not to the people, because it's very difficult to surrender to people. He surrendered to God. Lord, you are my God. I shall have no idols. I cannot imagine how you are, but you are my God, Lord. I put myself in your hands. We need to come in worship this way. We need to come into worship in this manner. Surrendering every situation to God. Not demanding answer, demanding God do something, not demanding God bless us, God do this, God do that. It's just simply the word says so. I obey, and maybe then I can come to surrender. Lord, I give you reverence. You have your agenda. You change the agenda. You change it, Lord. But I surrender to you. And then holiness, next one. To put it very simply, if we can see the holiness of God, I am your God. I'm the one who save you and draw you out of slavery. You will fear God in the right way. You will see how holy he is, and you will keep yourself within the limits, because you know that he can zap you anytime. The two commandments tells us that God is a holy God that we are worshiping. We must hold fast to God's standard. To be holy means to be set apart. And we don't say, oh, we are set apart, we are set apart. But I want to be set apart by you, God, to use, to be used, so that I will not conform to the world. That's what it means by holiness. Being set apart, not only on Sunday, you know. Are you set apart at your workplace, in your school, in your homes? Are you set apart in your decision and so on? So that's what it is. Holiness. I don't need to go down a lot of it. The fact that God is holy. In Isaiah, when he met God, and he didn't meet God because nobody can see God and live, it's clearly. But he says, I had this. I saw God seated there, and the seraphs and the seraphim all were doing all their things. Read in Isaiah chapter 6, I believe that was. When he said all of that, what did Isaiah says? Woe to me, for I am a man of unclean lips. And he fell down prostrate. I want to tell you something. It's only a vision. That's how holy God is. It's only a vision that God gave to him, his calling, that he could even fall down. And he know, I am finished. That's how holy God is. When we come into worship, do we come in this attitude? Lord, you are so holy. I am so unholy. It's not a matter of comparison or anything like that. We need to approach God in worship in this way. Then we can say, he is my God, and I have no idols beside him. Because that is what it means by I would worship God alone. Now, when we do this, as I recap very quickly, when we take his word as authority of life, when we obey it willingly at all cost, when you come into worship this way, when you give reverence, coming on his terms and agenda, not your terms, and not even knowing his agenda, when you surrender like Isaac did, when you choose to be set apart, to be salt and light, and say, make me that way, Lord. Make me that way. That's why I'm here. When we worship this way, you will encounter God like Simon Peter did. You will encounter God and you will experience like what Simon did, what I call inevitable transformation. You know, if you think carefully, you think of Isaiah, you think of Simon Peter. I say encounter, I think it's too easy a word to use. They experience something they have never experienced in their life. They experience the concern of God for them. They experience the care of God for him. They experience the love, the grace, and the mercy at a personal level, a real and personal relationship level. How can I have a God who loved me such a scum? How can I have a God who would do all this for me when I doubted him, when I don't care, and I was so reluctant in my obedience? How can it be God? Go away from me. I'm a sinner. And his life was transformed. That's what I mean by transformation. Inevitably, when we realize we are too unworthy of God, when we can come in to realize that we are but dirt and everything. I'm not talking about putting ourselves down, but we must know that we have a holy and a supreme God. And when you encounter him, inevitable transformation takes place. Now, let me say very quickly again. It brings them closer to God than ever before. It was not that they go away and they were ever closer to God than before. That's called transformation. Transformation takes place when you see the worth of God. That's my point. When you can see the worth of God, is God worthy of my worship alone? God alone is worthy of my worship. Nothing else. No idols shall take his place. The first commandment is the object of our worship. The second commandment is the approach of how we worship God. And when that transformation take place, your heart will overflow with joy. Your heart will be overflowed with compassion, with everything that God wants to do in you, as a result of which you will fall down and it's a transformation that takes place, like in Mark, our memory verse says, you will end up loving the Lord, your God, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. That's what happened. Inevitable transformation leads to a praise. Lord, I praised you. And it's often expressed by bowing down, kneeling down, prostrate, dancing, in some cases, when you experience a different form of God, a different element of God, clapping, raising of hands, singing out loud. All those results is not because of the worship of the song that we sang. It might be the lyrics. All those are a result of everything that takes place before that. The word, the obedience, the reverence, the surrender, understanding his holiness, you end up expressing it right from your heart. Loving God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. It will not be half-hearted anymore. Let me just move on as I conclude. Worship is not found in a segment, like sometimes we think. Worship segment, word segment, type segment. Worship is not found in that. Worship is found in the right attitude. It can be anywhere. It can be anywhere. Worship is not just found in church. You can be alone before God. And if you read the biography of a lot of our great missionaries, our great fathers of faith and everything, they said, one night I was there and I just knelt down and I couldn't stop crying. That's worship. That's worship. I want to conclude by asking you a few questions. A few questions that help you reflect and prepare yourself for worship every time when you want to worship God. Not only, I mean, in church here or anything like that, but just prepare yourself. Okay, I believe it will help you if you reflect on this. And I believe it will help you to go and say that, am I worshiping Him alone? Question number one. Does God need to fit inside your box of understanding before you fit Him into your life? When you worship God, how would you answer this question? Yes? No, or depends on which area. How would you answer this? Does God need to fit inside your box of understanding before you fit Him into your life? Think about idol worship. If He must fit into me, I'm an idol beside God. Just think about that. Reflect on the second one. How do you react? Now, how do you react? Maybe this will happen during worship. When God does something in your life that doesn't fit your picture of Him, do you allow God to proceed or do you rebel against Him? Do you shut down? How do you react? I don't like to hear that. I know, don't have to say anymore. Or, okay lah, everybody doing it, I do it lah. Obedience, but not surrender. God's agenda or your agenda? And finally, are you willing? I just chose 3 out of 10 that I wrote down. Are you willing to realign your life to fit God's standards? To fit God's standards? Or are you going to praise Him only when He fits into your lifestyle and doesn't require you to change? Henry Blackaby put it very well. He says, we do not listen to God's word and then obey like that. It doesn't shortcut like that. He said, when you listen to God's word, you will go through a crisis of faith. And even when after they say, I will take the step of faith, you have to go through another step and he called major adjustment. He made no qualms about adjustment. He said major adjustment. To some people, it might be very small, but to you, it will be major because that's the only area you need to give up. Just like a young, rich ruler. He don't need to make adjustment in his obedience of God in every way, anyway. It's only that will sell everything. Are you willing to align your life to fit God's standard? That's holiness. Or are you going to praise Him only when He fits into your lifestyle and doesn't require you to change? I prepared 2 songs to help us reflect upon this. And Elizabeth, would you just please play that for us? Would you just close your eyes? I think you know the songs well. You want to keep your eyes open, fine. But let these 3 questions flow through your mind. Yeah, go ahead, son. Thank you.
step down into darkness, open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Lord, you are so worthy, and Lord, you are so wonderful.